Hello, good evening, and welcome. How you guys doing? Good. Good to see you. Glad you guys can make it out. We think this is going to be a really special kind of an evening. I am Vernon Clarke, and I'm one of the curators for this art exhibit and one of the co-producers of this entire project. This was a project that we've been working on for some time now, and we're really excited about it, and we think that by the end of the evening, you will have learned a whole lot and gotten some insight into some very special people who did some very special things. So what we're going to do first is take a look at a short video, and then after that, we will move into our program. Okay.
But its core is African American. But basically, the way I started off is I put my colors in.
Dog is a looking fan. I think he's an incredible writer. Probably he and Pearl Clarke probably are the two greatest living playwrights in my opinion.
Language ideas, not, you know, they're theoretical philosophical ideas, but the language ideas are very
let us all in.
Nothing is what you're gonna get!
It's the life and times of young African American artists of South Florida from 1950 to 1970. They were called Highwaymen and were led by the handsome and charismatic Alfred Hair.
I'll say early 60s. I began teaching in the public school. And I was trying to find interesting things for art students to do because they had not had formal art classes before. And I wanted them to continue to want to take the class and not become bored. So I designed a field trip for them by taking them to the Bacchus Art Gallery and the home of Mr. Bacchus, who was a pretty well-known artist in this area. He painted landscapes, and I knew this would be interesting to the students because if he had been a painter of abstract art, I think I would have lost him. Previously, Mr. Bacchus had talked to me about helping any student who showed promise and interest. And I thought immediately of Alfred. So Alfred stayed there and did the framing. And he got so good, he said, well, I'm going to try this myself. Because he didn't want to go out in the fields and pick tomatoes and oranges, because that was all that was here for him to do. So this is when he decided that he wanted to paint. And when he started, he couldn't paint enough pictures to make any money because physically he just couldn't do it. So he decided that he would get his friends to help him. And this is when he started the assembly line. He'd take a piece of Upson board, this wall board, that you put inside houses for the walls after you frame them, and he would cut it up into sections. And he would nail them to the tree or fence in his yard. And he showed them how to paint in the sky. That's Alfred's picture right there in the center. That's probably one of his better ones because you can see the influence of Mr. Bacchus in that, where he took a lot of time and made a lot of detail. He showed them how to paint the blue in for the sky And then right in the center, or below the center of the picture, you would paint another color for the horizon. And down at the bottom, you paint water or grass or something to indicate the foreground. He would put all this on the tree, on these framed boards on the tree, and the guys would go along and paint the colors there the way he told them. And that's how he started, which is an assembly line. Then he would come along with his palette knife, looks like a little butter knife, and he would put in the trees, some birds in the sky or the clouds, and whatever, all the little details he wanted on the painting. Then he had taught somebody how to frame them, and they trained them for him. And I had told the fellas when they were starting this painting, I said, now you know, you won't be able to hang your paintings in the art gallery because of segregation. You won't be able to hang them in any of these places they sell paintings in town. They're not going to allow you to do that. So I said, if you get in the right place, people will buy anything. It's good or bad. If they like it, they're going to buy it. And that's how Alfred got started. They put them in the stack and put them in the back of the car, and off they go. And some of the paintings were still wet because it takes several days or weeks for them to dry completely. So he knew this, and he just put them in the car and went on down to the office buildings, to tourists on the streets, banks, anywhere he thought he could sell them.
Alfred wasn't a big man, but Alfred. Carried himself as a big man. When you looked at him, he walked with a sense of self assurance that everybody would pay attention to him. It seems as though he'd just bring life into his surroundings. But when we started painting out of this house in the 60s, it was nothing connected with the Highwaymen. We were out trying to make a living. But that brought into the tomato fields and orange grove. We found out that art would sell, and we could make our living doing that. Someone else gave us the name of the Highwaymen, not us. Painters or artists, we used to say an artist, they would come to the house and everybody would just paint.
and the Highwaymen is a story of a dreamer who triumphs over his environment while inspiring others to carry on his legacy.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kenesha Cook, and I will be your host and moderator for the Highwaymen Legacy of Community Dialogue. For tonight's event, you'll get a chance to meet a glimpse into the lives of these Florida artists who became known as the Highwaymen. You guys just got a chance to see the video. Despite the numerous obstacles placed before them, Alfred Hair and the Highwaymen were determined to make their mark in society as both artists and entrepreneurs. Now, I would like to introduce the person that was the force behind this project and who has a personal background connected to it. He's a filmmaker who witnessed the Highwaymen movement from an interesting perspective as it unfolded. He is currently the CEO of Take on the Arts, Mr. James Isaac.
Good afternoon. As mentioned, this project is personal to me. I grew up and I watched it happen. That young man there, Jimmy Stovall, and I fought every day. I never knew that he was going to turn into a fabulous artist. It has taken painstaking years to research this project and come up with something that we thought will best demonstrate this project. I made one phone call to Ms. Doretha Hair, Truesdell, and I made the other phone call to Jimmy. I mentioned to them what the idea was. They never blinked their eyes. The next thing I know, Doretha was pulling in the driveway around the back of the building here, her and her husband, John, tons of paintings of history that they, as well as myself, understood. In this lifetime of ours, history is happening all around us, but we usually wait for somebody else to determine it, to give it meaning. As this history was going down, as we were all growing up, we never saw it, because we were waiting on someone to define it for us. But as we grew old and we start to mature, we said, wait a minute. This can't happen again in our lifetime. This was like the Harlem Renaissance in New York. This was the Florida Renaissance. And we lived it, but we took it for granted, because it's one of those forests for the trees thing. But now, as we have grown and matured, we realize just how important this event in our lives was. And I'm glad that I'm here to witness it and to bear witness to what has happened in my lifetime. So you young people, in your lifetime, there is going to be some event that's historical. Don't wait for somebody else to define it for you. Stop, observe it, capture it, and give it its just meaning. Thank you once again, and thank you everybody for coming.
Thank you, Mr. Isaac. As the project moved along in its journey, it is joined by another person who saw the historical importance of social significance of the Highwaymen. After several insightful conversations with James, who shared the vision of this project, he jumped on board and has been part of the project ever since. He is the executive producer of Take on the Arts and is a professor at Clarke, Atlanta University. My friend, Mr. Vernon Clarke.
Good evening again. Yes, this, before I go any further, there's a couple of people I want to thank, because I think this would not be happening if they were not on board with this project as well. First person is Mr. Victor Simmons, who is the library administrator who opened up the doors to this wonderful facility to us. When I first talked with him about this, he immediately saw the vision. And he also has some Florida connections, too, I found out a little bit later. But he welcomed the project. And kind of that's why, you know, one of the main reasons why we're here today. Another person who's working, actually, upstairs is Mr. Morris Gardner. Morris has put in yeoman's work. He's really been godsend. He's been really very supportive, very helpful, and I can't thank him enough. Another person is Sharon Robinson. She's not here, but her husband is here, and she is the one who kind of forged the bridge, so to speak, and made all the connections possible for us to be here. And lastly, I'd like to thank Daniel Moss from HBCUConnect.com. They are actually doing some shooting of this event, and they will be posting it on their website. So I kind of wanted to thank those people because they were all important. Yes, how I got involved was kind of interesting. Again, I knew James had been working on this, and we had these conversations, and I immediately saw the vision too. This was a story that I don't think a lot of people knew about or still don't know about, but was one that was important. Because at the end of the day, it's stories that bind us together. Stories of yesterday, stories of today, stories of tomorrow. And I was asked a couple times, why this story? What is it about the Highwaymen that's so important? And it made me stop and think and say, wow, you know, that's a good question. And when I looked into it, when I kind of reflected on it, it was because they did something. These young black men and one woman did something at a time when they weren't supposed to do it. They became artists and entrepreneurs during a very turbulent time in American history, particularly in the South. So what they did, what they accomplished, needs to be recognized, and people need to know about it. And we're at a point where I think we're looking at stories from the past that help define who we are, whether it be Hidden Figures, whether it be A Birth of a Nation, whether it be Henrietta Lacks. The Highwaymen will become part of that mosaic that we call America. So I think this is a very important story, and I hope that when you leave here tonight, you'll have a slightly better understanding of who they were and what they contributed to American society. Thank you.
Thank you, Vernon. Now we would get a chance to meet a person that was directly connected to the Highwaymen. She was once married to Alfred Hair, the founder of the Highwaymen, and she played an integral role in helping the art movement come to be. She's an active painter herself and has an extensive collection of original Highwaymen paintings, in which are currently exhibited in the gallery, which everyone has drawn from. She is Doretha Hair Truesdell.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming. I know each person has something else that they could be doing this evening, but you chose to be and spend your time with us. For that, I thank you. Well, my journey with the Highwaymen at the time was not the Highwaymen. It was just my husband and I trying to make a living painting and selling art. I first met Alfred in 1959 after relocating to Fort Pierce, Florida from Glen White, West Virginia. Our father had killed our mother, and my older sister was living in Fort Pierce, and she brought seven of us to Fort Pierce. And part of the family, if you would stand up, please. They're in. That's my second youngest sister, Mrs. Peggy. McIntosh. That's my niece, Shanalyn. And these are her, two of her sons and her daughter. Thank you all. And after Alfred and I, we built a house after I graduated from college at Florida A&M. We built a house on Dunbar Street where I reside today. And after we built the house, we were able to extend a studio onto it. And with that, we were able to paint about 10 to 20 paintings a day. Peggy was at the house with us after part of the time. We were selling the paintings for about $25. And at that time, in the 50s and early 60s, $100 a day was not bad. That was pretty decent living. And we would get in our car, and that's how they came up with the name the Highwaymen, because we would get in the car and go up and down the highway selling paintings, knocking on, going into doctor's office, motels, hotels, any place and ask, do you want to see our paintings? And we were selling quite a bit, but we were able to hire salespeople. And that's when we hired Al Black. When we hired salesperson Al Black, we really started making good money. He was making good money, but Al could sell you anything. And he was selling our paintings. And other people saw how well he was doing, so they wanted to be a salesman. And Mr. Jimmy Stovall was dating, at that time, my sister Peggy. And he learned how to make frames at the house, because you didn't come to our house and just date my sisters. If you came to our house, you were going to work. And so Jimmy started off making frames. So I guess smelling the paint got to him. So he started painting later on. And most of the people, and I would call a core group, of the Highwaymen. If you looked at the film, you saw, I think, Livingston Roberts, who is now deceased, but he was at the house frequently. Roy McClendon, Bud, Al Black. We had another salesman, Clarence Banks. He was our salesperson before Al Black, but Al outsold Clarence. And so it was always competition among the artists, competition among the salespeople. And our lives were going really well. We had four children when Alfred was killed. Alfred Jr., Sherry, Roderick, and Lisa. Lisa really never saw her father to know him. She was 7 weeks old when he was killed. And when Alfred got killed, that's when the whole, if you want to say, movement just sort of fell apart. Everybody went their own way. Most people got jobs, and I think Al Black didn't. He still tried to sell and paint. And in the 1990s, this white gentleman, Jim Finch, saw all of this art, this beautiful Florida art, and he started asking questions and then found out that the black self-taught artists painted these paintings. So he gave them the name the Highwaymen. And in 2004, they were inducted into the Florida Artists Hall of Fame. And everything really took off. Everybody started painting then, because the prices of the art went up. And to this day, the ones that are still alive, including myself, are still painting. Thank you for this.
Sorry, I had to put my shoes back on. Thank you, Ms. Doretha. The Highwaymen were artists who were not only artists who painted beautiful landscapes in Florida, but they captured a moment in time. The artist is referred to as the 27th Highwayman, and he also is an artist and art historian who has studied the culture and historical relevance of the group of artists. He was a longtime gallery owner and is still an active painter. Guys, Mr. Jimmy Stovall.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think Doretha kind of summed it all up. But my career started when I met my childhood sweetheart, who's still sitting in the audience now. And I was so infatuated with this young lady till I was at their house more than they were. One day, Alfred came in and said, "Son, who are you?" I said, "Well, I'm Peggy's boyfriend." He said, "Well, if you're going to be here as much as I am, you're going to be working." So he taught me how to make the Highwayman frame out of molding. And that went on for a while. I'm the type of person that I don't like for anybody to have anything over me that I can't do. But I watched Alfred and I studied his profile, how he painted, and he would talk to you. So one day I decided, well, he bought me a car. He bought me my first car. It was a 1956 Chevy Bel Air. It was gold and black. I'll never forget that car. He didn't want to buy it because it didn't have an engine in it. But I talked him into it and we finally got it running. But I had a responsibility then. I had a girlfriend that I had to feed at the drive-in, popcorn and soda. I had a car I had to fix up. So at 25 cents a frame, I wasn't making that much money. So I decided, well, if I could paint, then I could make a little bit more money. So one day I decided to try my hand at it. And I thought I heard Alfred coming, but it wasn't. It was Peggy coming in, and I hid the painting. But I forgot about it. And I don't know what made Alfred look under here, under there, where I hid it at, but he was looking for something. And he found it. When I came in from school, Peggy and I both were in school. When I came in from school, he had the painting tacked up on the wall. I said, "Oh man, I lost my job. I ain't gonna see my lady no more." He came in, he said, "Did you do that?" I said, "Yeah, but I think I kind of messed it up. So you can just take the paint out of my check, out of my pay." He said, "I ain't worried about the pay." He said, "I want to know when you're gonna finish it." That started my career as an artist. I studied Alfred, and I have a couple of paintings that I painted that I got into an argument with another collector who said that I scratched Alfred's name off and put my name on it. That's just how close I studied Alfred's work. When the book came out, there was a guy by the name of Jim Fitch, as she touched on, by the name of Jim Fitch. He was commissioned to do a study and write an essay on black artists in this area. As the story goes, everything he researched led him to this group in Fort Pierce. And there was a bunch of us. And we didn't, it wasn't that we just didn't want to pick fruit. I'm just going to be straight with you. We didn't want to work in the groves. We didn't want to pick fruit. This was an easy way where my mother was bringing home $60 a week. I saw an opportunity to bring home $60 a day and get her off of her knees scrubbing floors. We had guys that came in. This guy came in and he did this study on this group, and everything he found led him to this Alfred Hair group. He wrote his article. I talked to one of the artists who I was very good friends with, Robert Butler. Robert Butler said that he had this, the guy called him in, because they were friends, called him in, and then he had a bunch of names that he wanted him to look over. He said, pick out one of them names. I gotta put a title to you guys. And Butler looked down there, and he said, well, this one will fit Highwaymen. But they thought they were gonna have issues with picking that name, because Waylon Jennings had a group called the Highwaymen. What's the other country western guy? There was a Highwayman motorcycle group. So they thought they were gonna have some issues with it. They wrote the article. Gary Monroe read the article. He decided to come to town and do a book on the whole group. He found 26 of the artists, interviewed them. They looked for me. I was working Hurricane Andrew down in Miami, where there was no communication. There was nothing, no trees, no shade, no nothing. So they didn't get a chance to interview me, but they mentioned me in the book. Gary Monroe wrote a book about the Highwaymen. A year after that book hit Barnes & Noble, we were the most sought after artists in the state of Florida, and it has been growing ever since. Now, a lot of people have made money off the Highwaymen. And we have Highwaymen who we had to collect money to bury. So we, along with Ms. Hair Truesdell, we have decided that we're gonna do this ourselves. We wanna keep the legacy going. We want our grandkids to when they open up their history books, they can read about the Highwaymen. I do lectures now about the Highwaymen in public schools or different schools. I go around to different organizations. I've been called to do lectures. But the Highwaymen, we actually had no idea that this was gonna go this far. At the time, like I said, I started painting so I can take her to the movies in a decent looking car. And a lot of the other ones painted because they didn't want to, you have to be cut out for picking fruit, being a farmer. And a lot of them weren't cut out for that. And I urge all, especially the young people, if you have a talent, stick with that talent. Don't let anybody take you away from it. Don't let anybody talk you out of it. Even if that talent is not putting food on the table or paying the bills, you stick with it. Do like I did. My artwork was not paying my bills. My artwork was not giving me the things that I wanted. But I stuck with it. I got me a job at the phone company. I did 36 years. I've been retired 8 years now. But I still have the passion to paint. I was featured in, when you stick with stuff, doors open. This is our first time in Atlanta. Absolutely. First time in Atlanta. This is our second time out of the state of Florida. So doors are opening. If you stop what you want to do, then it stops. It ends. We want to keep the legacy going. We have kids coming up. Y'all can ring the bell if I'm overdoing my time. But we have kids coming up that want to learn how to paint. And like Alfred Hair, he was not selfish. He would teach anybody to paint. He got the opportunity to live his life the way he wanted to live it. And I am proud to say that I was a part of that. I was right there with him. So this, if you have a talent, stick with it. Don't let anybody talk you out of it. One day, it'll pay off. Any talent that you have, if you're good at it, it's a God's gift. Don't give up on God's gift. Thank you.
I love that speech, Mr. Jimmy. Definitely, like he said, definitely follow your passions. One person always told me, do what you have to do so one day you can do what you want to do. So I definitely love that speech. We're going to open it up for a little bit of Q&A. Does the audience have any questions that they'd like to ask? Don't be shy, beautiful people. If not, I'll ask the questions. So we'll pass around a microphone. Okay, we have a, anybody have the microphone up? Rob, you have the microphone. Thank you, Rob.
Ringing.
Is it on?
Yeah, that's it.
Testing.
Yeah. I want to thank James and Vernon for introducing Atlanta to the Highwaymen. You know, what's really fascinating for me is this was a community economic development effort at a time when we didn't necessarily think about art as being that. And so a collective of people came together, driven by Alfred and Doretha. What was the glue, other than money, that held people together to create this collective, to keep people pumping out artwork and moving it forward?
I think it was camaraderie. We really had good times together. We actually painted, we worked together, but we socialized and we had fun together. And with the sense that you were doing what you love to do and enjoying it. And I know that's what held us together. And Alfred was really the catalyst, that the glue that held everyone together. Because when he passed, everybody just collapsed, because he kept us together.
All right, any more questions? Anybody have another question? One in the back. Mr. Isaac, you need to turn off your phone.
Did you ever deal with any adversity because you chose to paint instead of working in the groves?
I didn't understand the question. I'm so sorry.
Oh, it's Jimmy. Oh, okay.
Not really. The times came when we were out on the road, and it didn't last long once they saw what we had. Working in the groves was just back-breaking work, and you got to understand, you wouldn't never see this. In those days, the only job for a black man was working the groves or janitorial. It was unheard of. At the time I met Alfred Hair, it was unheard of for a black man to be driving a Cadillac. And he had one. His friend had one. So they were doing pretty well. But there were times on the road when I went out with Al Black, we were told, don't come in here with that garbage. I don't want to see that. Get out of here. We've had the police call on us. I can remember one time we went in a place and I was scared to death. And this guy told us, say, these are his words. You niggas get out of here with that mess. I don't want you in here. Al Black humbled down and played the country boy. Sir, I just need a couple of dollars. I gotta feed my little brother here. He been sick and I gotta feed him. We sold that man 7 paintings. 7. So it's all in how you approach. I've seen on TV where, you know, somebody will say something derogatory to you. You get upset. That's what they intend to do. Upset you. And I want to tell everybody, don't let people lead you around like that. And somebody tell you something derogatory, or you just tell them, say, you just that stupid to think that's embarrassing to me. Or you that stupid to think that hurts my feeling. And walk away. But That was about the most of it. I mean, there were certain places we couldn't go. Like, we couldn't go downtown after dark. So, but for selling paintings and working in the groves and they didn't care who worked in the groves as long as they got the fruit picked. If you were not there, they find somebody else. That answer your question? Okay.
Yeah. I knew it took a long time.
Well, Mr. Jimmy, you're better than me. I probably would have been slapping somebody around back in the day. Any other questions? Anybody have any other questions? No?
We have some questions.
Okay. Rob, can you bring the microphone up here?
How you guys doing? Okay, so I wanted to ask a question about you saying, like, now since, you know, your group has been highlighted in Florida, like, what are some of the events that's going on now to showcase, you know, like, the importance of the Highwaymen? Like, are y'all having a documentary done or?
Well, the city of Fort Pierce really honors the Highwaymen. This is the second year that we are having the Highwaymen Festival. It's February the 18th. And documentaries are out, and have been out, and it's going around about a movie's being made. I'm still waiting on seeing it. Our trailer is out, but I'm waiting on the actual movie to see if it's really going to happen. But it doesn't, the Highwaymen movement, our story is continuing. It doesn't die. And it will live on, I think, forever. Because the art that you see upstairs is over 50 years old, majority of it. It's on Upson board, and it was done mostly in the 60s. So that art and it looks as though it was painted yesterday. And as long as the art is alive, the history will continue.
Also, I'm not too good with these new things. Also, we've been featured in, well, there's been several books written about us. There's been several documentaries done about the Highwaymen. I was working in with the phone company in Alabama. I had been sent to Alabama to help out up there for a couple of months. And I walked into a thrift store to see if they had frames or a piece of glass where I can mix my paint. And the lady asked me, she had a glass out of a microwave. She asked me what I was gonna do with it, and I explained it to her, and I gave her one of my cards. Come to find out, her and her husband had just watched a documentary on the Highwaymen 3 days before I walked into their shop. So that's just how the Highwaymen have moved around. I went on to tell you that I was the first black to be featured in a antique and art show in West Palm Beach at the convention center. Not that they were prejudiced, but the spot, which was 500 square feet, cost $45,000 to get. I ain't have to pay that. You have to get investors. The guy that contacted me had investors. They were putting him in the show. It only happens twice a year. Twice in a year. Once in the United States and once in Europe. He didn't have enough inventory to fill up 500 square feet. So he called a highwayman. We went down, I shut my whole gallery down, went down, and we did pretty well. I was the first black to ever be featured in that show because of the price, not because of color or anything like that. But I forget what we were talking about, man.
I think you answered the question. Did you say he's getting old? Huh? He's not old.
Did that answer
black
your question?
Black don't crack. Huh?
You can tell him to shut up when you get ready, man.
I want to quickly piggyback on what they just said.
What James and I are looking to do is develop a feature film about the life and times of the Highwaymen. Featured really about surrounding Doretha and Alfred and what became of them. And also we're looking at possibly even doing a tour with this, taking them to the HBCUs, because I think this is a natural for HBCUs in terms of the art and the history. So there are several things out there that we're looking at and exploring. So we'll see what develops from that.
Mr. Azzi, do you want to say something? Turn it on.
Just to pick up on what Mr. Clarke said, you know, this moment in time has to be told. And I listened to Jimmy and I listened to Doretha. See, I've been interviewing Doretha since 2006 concerning the Highwaymen. Every time I would come home, John, thank you very much, because John gave me his space. He would see me walk through the door with cameras and light since 2006. Interviewing Doretha. You know I can't thank you enough for that. You never offered me anything to eat, but thank you anyway. And I've been talking to Jimmy, pulling things out of him. When, in 2006, when I went to Fort Pierce, I began to dig up all the old skeletons, interviewing everybody who was in the bar, Eddie's bar, the night Alfred was murdered. I found people who were half alive themselves, faded memories. There was a sheriff in our town called Pat Duval. We all knew him. Pat was the first black sheriff in Blacktown. See, Fort Pierce was really called Blacktown there. Pat must be, what, about 96 now? He has to be. But Pat knew us all. When I went around to see him, and I hadn't been in Fort Pierce almost 30 years, when I walked through his door, he said, "How you doing, man? How's your mother?" That's how good Pat's memory was. But Pat was the arresting officer. Well, not necessarily the arresting officer, because the murderer turned himself in the next day. And Pat told me who was all in the bar and made sure that I got the police report of that night. So I had a beginning for my research. So I went around asking people. They hadn't seen me since I was a kid, so naturally there was somewhat of resentment. You know, you're coming down there digging up old wounds and opening old doors, and the strange thing about every black person in Fort Pierce, everybody's got a Highwayman story, and everybody don't mind telling you. And there's a lot of fabrication going on with that also. So with the information in which I got from Doretha and Jimmy, that was what we call nowadays our fact check. Because if what you're telling me didn't jive with what Doretha and Jimmy telling me, because Doretha and Jimmy basically told me the same story. As a matter of fact, Peggy don't remember this, but me and Alvin Bo talked to you up here in what, 2010 or 12? And that's why, and you didn't remember me when I walked up to you? And see, there are still some people around and alive who remembers this time. However, there's a lot in our generation that choose to forget that time. There's a young man sitting back there in a maroon shirt. We call him Boot, but his name is Earl Mimes. He's a distant cousin of Alfred. He knew what was going on during that time because he was a kid during that time. Although he has faded memories, but basically he knew exactly what was going on in Fort Pierce, because as Jimmy and Doretha said, the only source of employment for an African American was the fruit field. I wasn't born in Fort Pierce. My family moved there in 1955. I literally lived in Fort Pierce for 12 years. And this happened during my time in Fort Pierce. I saw it go down, but I didn't place any value on it. So I had to come back to these resources. It just so happened that I knew this young man here. It just so happened that I knew Doretha. Doretha knew my aunt. I came to your house, Peggy, because, you know, Doretha, y'all used to have the best parties in town around there. Trust me when I tell you this. As a matter of fact, in your living room, it's almost like a sunken living room, one step down. See, and there was the fishnet, and Alfred's painting was in the back of the Muriel. I mean, the place was jumping, okay? But you had to be a certain age to be there, because don't forget, this is like middle 60s. I'm 66 years old, so in 1965, I was 15. I left Fort Pierce 2 years later. So, you know, we were kids, so to be able to hang out at Doretha and Alfred's crib, I mean, that was all right, you know. We had a great time there. But in my research, I found out a whole lot about the era, because it happened, I was in New York in 1970 when Alfred was murdered. So I interviewed everybody who was in the bar. I even interviewed his assailant. And what really broke my heart was that he told me out of his mouth, he said, "I asked God to forgive me." He had found Jesus, of course, because he was an elderly man at that time. And he said, "I'm no better off now than I was when I killed that guy." He said, "I'm doing the same type of work." And he said, "I hope God have mercy on my soul." He wouldn't let me put a camera on him, but he let me interview him over the phone. And I could see that he was a man who was torn by his deeds, because literally, he killed the golden goose. Am I right or wrong, Peggy, Doretha? Alfred was the golden goose. He kept Fort Pierce alive. As a matter of fact, all the high school teachers in town, they weren't making no money teaching school. Who loaned the money? The banks darn sure didn't. It was Alfred. I bet you had a whole lot of money due you, didn't you? Never came back. But Alfred was the golden goose. As Doretha said in the tape, when he walked in, if Alfred walked through that door, trust me, you would look, because he carried himself that. Men of my generation, Jimmy included, Alfred taught us how to walk, how to dress, how to hold your head, how to be confident in yourself. And believe me or not, we all got some Alfred in us. Trust me when I tell you that. Am I right, Jimmy? We all got some Alfred in us, because we saw him the way this y'all young generation look up at Jay-Z and Kanye and whoever these people are. Guess what? Alfred was our guy.
He was a prankster, too.
Oh, yes. And on top of that, trust me when I tell you this, he taught us how to dress. See, you did not wear your pants all of different kind of ways. You had to have a crease in your pants. I bet Jimmy Stovall got a crease in his pants right now. I bet Jimmy Stovall shined his shoes right now. See, that's the way we were taught. When you came down Avenue D, you had to have your you-know-what together. Your shirt had to be in your pants. We got that from Alfred. He was the trendsetter. And goodness knows, the man just seemed to be able to just, whatever he touched turned to gold. I've watched Alfred in our pool room. Bullied. Just take a guy's heart. Because the guy was too busy watching him, the way he moved. He was charismatic. The way he moved around the table, the way he would make a shot and turn around and look you in the eyes, it was frightening you like. But that was part of his appeal, and he understood that. He gave us everything. And that's why I'm here. That's why Doretha and Jimmy is here. Because he's the trendsetter. If you ever met him, I was interviewing Doretha in her house. I heard a noise, and you know, when you're filming, when you hear noise, noise disturb you. And I turned around, and it was her son, and I thought it was Alfred. I almost jumped out of my... You remember Doretha? I turned around and it was like, oh, it was so frightening because he looks just like his father, you know. And I'm like, I'm sitting here interviewing her about Alfred, and all of a sudden I turn around and there's a son standing there. I hadn't seen him, I guess, since he was a little crawling since that. But that's the impact that he had on us, and that town there is still alive. They have the Highwaymen's Walk, in which is mentioned, Doretha mentioned in the small film, that honors them. Alfred Grave has this beautiful Ponciana tree on it. Hibiscus tree on it. If you see it, it's a work of art. The city itself has opened their arms to this because this is the greatest thing that ever happened to Fort Pierce. Trust me when I tell you this. If it wasn't for the Highwaymen, Fort Pierce wouldn't even be on the map. Well, Zora Neale Hurst was there also, and I'm quite sure you guys know about her. She and Alfred were contemporaries. They were friends. She, Alfred, Miss Jefferson, Alfred Arts teacher, and Beanie Backus. They used to sit around and have talk about social changes, I guess. And if you notice one thing about Alfred, he never painted any black movement paintings. During that time, what was in style, I guess, was that the velvet? Yeah, that velvet religious painting. Who told me this? Somebody told me this. Alfred said, who gonna buy that? So you need to paint something that's gonna sell. He understood it. He understood marketing. One of the guys told me, said Alfred told him, say, listen, shine your shoes, comb your hair, put your shirt in your pants, and get out of the way of the sale. He said, white people will buy from you if you look like you're not trying to rob them. He said, make the presentation and get out of the way. Now that means that this young man had an understanding of marketing. He understood it. Of course, he had a gift for gab, because the highwayman that Doretha mentioned, Al Black could sell the devil some fire. Trust me when I tell you that. He was just that good. These men had to come up with a way of survival, because they did not want to do that backbreaking labor. I don't care how hard you work in that field, you could make no more than $6 or $7 a day. And we had some fruit picking brothers down there, didn't we? I mean, they could snatch some fruit, but it didn't matter. You weren't gonna make no more than $6 or $7 a day, because that was all that was there for you. Once again, I guess I've talked over because, you had something to say, Boo?
No. I don't
know. Is there any last questions? Anybody have any?
Because see, that young man there, he lived it. He lived it. He absolutely lived it. You know, and everything that I say can be fact checked. He lived it. I know him, his brothers, his sisters, his mama, I know everybody in his family. But, you know, this is where, and I will claim it, even though I wasn't born in Fort Pierce, I claimed Fort Pierce because I think it was a marvelous place to grow up. I have two sons living, sitting back there. I wish they could have, and I tell them, and I told them this the whole lot, I wish they could have the childhood that I had. Just the childhood that I had, because, boop, this guy here, we had the best childhood in the world. We would go from sun up to sundown. No one had to worry about us because everybody in the community knew us. If there was a pedophile there, nobody knew nothing about it. Nobody took anything from anyone. The only time there was a murder amongst us is when probably some migrant worker got into it or something with each other. But basically, we got along. Everybody knew each other. There was love. There was no hunger in our town. Never any hunger. There was no homelessness in our town. Avenue D came straight through the heart of black community, and that was the financial and the business district. People all over the world know about Avenue D because it was a swinging place. We had joints galore. Black businesses, doctors, lawyers there, what we had, restaurants. It was the heart of the black community. And I've told my sons that I have one foot in segregation and the other foot in integration. They've heard me tell them this their whole lives. And trust me, that segregation thing wasn't too damn bad at all. Because the black dollars stayed in the black community. Right now, black dollars stay in the black community 6 hours, and it's gone, never to return again. Alfred Hair led the charge. Alfred showed everybody what they can do by doing it himself. Thank you, everybody, and I appreciate you. You got something to say, but would you keep holding up your hand?
All right, if there are no more questions.
Thank you, everybody.
Tonight was indeed a special, oh, sorry, there's another, I'm sorry. Somebody has another question?
Hello, I want to ask a question. Are your artworks only in Florida? Is it anywhere else?
Are your artworks anywhere else besides Florida?
It's all over.
Like?
Florida, outside of D.C.
All right.
And a lot of tourists come through South Florida, and those were really and truly the target for the Highwaymen. So there are people all over the country, possibly world, that have their work artwork.
Canada, all over.
James Gibson has sold paintings to the Prime Minister of Japan. We have a lot of, as a matter of fact, he said he was I'll think of it in a minute, but he was with this company, he was going over to Japan to visit with some high-ranking corporate people, and he bought, I used to paint these 5x7s. I don't do them anymore because it takes just as long to do a 5x7 as it do a 24x36. It takes a lot of time. But I used to paint these 5x7s, and I used to call them my gas money paintings, where if I went to a show and didn't make any money, I could sell them for $50, $60 just to get gas. But this guy came in and he bought about 10 of those. So those paintings are in Japan. We have a lot of paintings that just floating around the world. I have, Mary Ann Carroll and I have at least 10 paintings apiece in, was it Martha's Vineyard?
Martha's Vineyard.
Yeah. Martha's Vineyard. So the work is traveling around. Used to be you could go to a thrift store and pick up one for $4 or $5. They've been all cleaned up. Some of Alpha's work, well, most of Alpha's work is very, very hard to find. And in the coming years, although he was the fastest painter, his work is going to become very, very valuable, very valuable, because he was the man. And
what's happening with the art is that collectors are selling the art among themselves and boosting the price. So the price of the art is extremely high nowadays. It didn't used to be so, but the collectors saw the value of the art, so they started buying it up, and then they would sell it to each other, and each time they boost the price, so the prices have really skyrocketed.
Any other questions? I'm sorry.
It's everywhere.
I saw something on Facebook about you all at the White House.
We were at the White House, but we weren't at the White House for our art. But I think James Gibson did, for the White House Christmas tree, did ornaments.
Oh,
I think
beautiful.
He did some ornaments, yes.
Any last questions?
And one more note on that. Mary Ann Carroll presented. Mary Ann Carroll was invited by First Lady Obama, and she presented her with a painting. So she has one of her paintings. We've done exhibits at the Florida House in Washington, D.C., but never at the White House. Gibson is the only one that was there, and he did an ornament for a Christmas tree decoration.
All righty. Going once, going twice. Okay. So tonight was indeed a special event that we got to share with some unique artists. We heard their stories of the challenges as well as triumphs and why it's important that the legacy of the Highwaymen be continued for further generations. Now you can pass along the history and the story of the Florida Highwaymen. And thank you guys so much for coming. Good night. Stay classy. Oh, we also, too, I meant to say, you guys also, you can view some of the paintings upstairs. So if you haven't had a chance to view the beautiful paintings, you can go upstairs in the gallery. There's also wine and hors d'oeuvres in there, so don't get too drunk off the wine. So, and that's it. Thank you, guys.